Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Faculty of Nursing's very unique event that I'm so honored to be allowed to act as host and moderator for. Before we get started, though, I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region in Southern Alberta, which includes the Blackfoot Confederacy, comprising the Siksika, Piikani, and Kainai First Nations, as well as the Tsuut'ina First Nation and the Stoney Nakoda, including the Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nations. And the city of Calgary is also home to Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3. My name is Dr. Catherine Laing, and like I said, I am so happy to and honored to host this event. And before I introduce the man of the hour, Dr. Mike Laing, no relation to me, we have the same last name, different spelling. I just thought I'd maybe outline how this is going to go. Soon I will turn this over to Mike, and he will give a context and background setting for his documentary that he's made and will show. And then as you're watching the documentary and you think of questions, please feel free to put them in the question and answer box or the chat. And at the end of the documentary, we will have a moderated discussion with all of your questions with myself and Mike, of course, and then two other members of Mike's supervisory committee who are here today, Drs. Nancy Moules and Dr. Deb McLeod. And without further ado, I would love to introduce Mike. So Mike Laing is His accolades are numerous. He is a digital storytelling facilitator, researcher, filmmaker, and very recent PhD graduate at the University of Calgary. Mike has directed and produced 5 feature-length documentaries and 2 web series about the human health experience, in addition to publishing academic research articles and facilitating the creation of over 800 digital stories. His professional and research focus is on using digital storytelling and documentary filmmaking in education, advocacy, quality improvement, research, and in a therapeutic capacity within healthcare systems. So without further ado, Mike, take it away.
Awesome. Thanks, Catherine. Man, those bios always sound just a little better when you write them than when you read them, don't they? Sorry for the run-on sentence. Anyways, thank you all for being here today. Really appreciate you spending some time with us this afternoon. And I won't talk too much because I want to make sure that we have lots of time for our chat afterwards. But I would be remiss if I didn't open with just a couple of acknowledgments before we get going. Because one of the things that I think will become very clear through the film and the discussion today is that both digital storytelling and hermeneutic research are co-creative activities. And through the process of my PhD, I've gained a deeper understanding of how co-created I am. And I'm very appreciative of all the people who've had a hand in creation of both the film and the written thesis that came from it. So first, really quickly, just thanking Catherine as my supervisor. She read so many chapter drafts and helped me with so many APA mistakes. And I just really appreciated having her as a core piece of this interpretive community that I was in as I was writing this. Also Nancy and Deb, who we'll get to meet in a bit. I couldn't imagine a better group of people to go on a sort of an interesting journey like this of a PhD. Second, I'd like to acknowledge the Eyes High Doctoral Recruitment Scholarship, which got me going, and the CIHR Frederick Banting and Charles Best Doctoral Research Award for funding my PhD studies and the film that you'll see today. And finally, I have to thank all the young adult cancer survivors in the film, but also the thousands of other cancer survivors and supporters that I've met over the past 13 years since my own diagnosis of cancer as a 25-year-old. And in the dedication of my thesis, I wrote, "To all the young adult cancer survivors and supporters I have met, if I have any wisdom to offer the world, it has come from the stories and experiences you've shared with me." And that's not hyperbole. As an angry, sort of disillusioned 25-year-old cancer survivor, it was by listening to the stories of other young adults who were further along in their survivorship experience that helped me to cultivate a deeper understanding of my own emotions and really begin to craft meaning from that difficult experience. You know, the healthcare system provided me with a wealth of facts and knowledge about my cancer, but it was the stories of my peers that gave me the wisdom I needed to live well with, through, and beyond it. And so hopefully that's what we will be learning a little bit more today through the film. You know, we'll watch the film to see what wisdom it could have for us today. And the film we're about to watch was made as the data collection for my PhD thesis. And very excited to talk a bit more about that with all of you afterwards. And of course, hear from Catherine, Nancy, and Deb. But I really see both digital storytelling and documentary filmmaking as real great opportunities in health research to explore experiences, the human health experience that can be hard to capture sometimes in other different ways of sort of looking at the health experience. So I'm not going to talk anymore. Let's watch the film. And think of any questions or ideas or thoughts you would like to present afterwards. We'd be happy to discuss those in the panel discussion. So here we go. Emerging Horizons.
Everyone can find commonalities in these stories. I can say the logistical pieces of my story, like on this date I got this and this is what happened, but that doesn't really show like my true feelings.
I've told people that story, but I don't know if people realize how profound it was for me, I guess.
I try not to think about it too much, because then I go down like a worrying spiral.
I have all these what if questions that I'm like, what if my story sucks? What if it's terrible? What if I don't finish it?
Is it going to, you know, be exhausting? Is it going to be too much to handle? You never know.
It's going to be really hard on many different levels. So,
it's funny, it's a year ago, but even as I talk about this, I feel emotional. And so I know it still has a grasp over me in some ways. So I hope the more I say it out loud, the more I can release that.
Really, the goal of tonight is just to start thinking of our cancer experience or our life as a story. And the easiest way to do that is to find moments. So we're just going to spend a few minutes right now thinking about two moments in your life where everything changed that are somehow related to your cancer experience. The goal here is just to listen deeply to your own stories and experiences to see what stands out to you.
So one of the things I think we all probably have is like when you're told you have cancer, life kind of is like full stop. You're like, holy shitballs.
My daughter was only 18 months and I had gone into the doctor's office really not expecting a cancer diagnosis.
I heard the word lymphoma and I like was pretty sure that it was cancer, but I like I wasn't 100% sure.
Right.
Yeah, so
and I was like, well, you can't tell anyone.
Right.
And she was like, well, like, no, kids, we have to. And I was like, no, like, no one needs to know that I'm sick. Like, I don't want them to feel bad for me. Like, can't it just be a secret? Like, why does anyone have to know?
It's more about the process itself. With the doctor and him kind of saying that he thought facial paralysis was imminent.
They're just like doing all the logistic stuff and they're not actually listening to like the emotional side of it. And like, I don't know about you, but like, I hate a lot of that emotional stuff to make it easier for everybody else.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Come on back, everybody. So is there anyone who'd be willing to share one of their moments with all of us?
I can go.
Yeah.
So my moment is the stop sign that is outside my isolation room, and I'm walking towards it, and I realize that behind that stop sign is where I'm gonna be.
My emotions kind of just built up, and then there was a moment where it all just released, and I didn't really know I was bottling it up, but it was a big moment, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And in between all my testing, I found out that I was pregnant with our second child, and my big thing when I got the positive test result was I didn't have any joy because I knew that something bad was already going to happen. So just the juxtaposition between the two experiences with the two different pregnancies were,
yeah.
That was my big thing.
Now we're gonna actually just spend a couple minutes thinking about why were those moments so important? And we already, you know, heard a bit from Amanda, right? We know why that moment was so important for her.
Okay, theme. So I kinda had said, in my moment, I was feeling vulnerable and scared. Cancer, I didn't know what that meant other than that people can die from it. And then I was telling Amanda, on the flip side of that, it took me a really, really long time to get diagnosed. So I almost felt this like triumph validation feeling, like, ha, I told all you people something was wrong with me, but I'm gonna die, but yeah, but I'm gonna die. So it was like a really weird feeling.
So the final sort of activity for the night is we're gonna try and situate the moments that you've selected.
Right? Wait, this sounds familiar.
Yeah, Starry Mountain. You know, everyone probably learns it at some point in grade 4, grade 5, but it's just a useful place to start, right? It's not that you have to use this structure, but it's sort of this five phases of a story. See if you can pick, first of all, a climax moment and an inciting incident in your story, and then start to fill in some of these details. How's it going?
Hey, it's going.
It's going. Yeah. So you're able to find, see, you got a few things written down.
Yeah. Yeah, I know what it is. I just, I'm very, like, anxious about sharing it.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah.
And why is that?
It's because of a feeling that the community that supported me so much would be angry or...
Not understand.
They, yeah.
I had to terminate that pregnancy in order to have chemo and basically save my own life. You know, you lost the second child that you wanted to have, and then you don't know if you can have children, and then your doctor telling you to wait because the cancer could come back, and there's all these decisions, and you're trying to balance what you want and then all your fears and the different outcomes.
I'm kind of going off of this stop sign.
Love it. You're starting to develop a central metaphor, which is awesome. Because, you know, you can use the metaphor to explain how you're feeling internally through imagery.
Okay.
Right? So it's beautiful. So what about going past it was meaningful for you? So I hope you sort of have at least some ideas percolating. The more prepared you are, the more fun you're going to have.
Cool. All right, thanks, Kelsey. Are you you're okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah,
okay. This is all I think about a certain day, and it just always comes out.
Yeah, no doubt. Cool. Well, you know, just let us know.
Yeah.
If you want to chat with someone, and yeah, I can connect you with that person if you want.
No, I'm good, but thank you.
Okay, all right, cool.
Thanks for checking in.
Great. Really? Anyone you want. Let's see what happens.
Okay.
I'm taking this, though.
I'm a creature of habit, so I'll sit in my same spot.
All right.
I haven't done creative writing in a while.
I know, yeah. I guess you probably do it every once in a while with your kids.
But like, about Pokemon and, like,
yeah.
Like kid stuff, not real life.
Hey, Bethany. I talked a lot with Amanda this week, and she was finding it a lot more emotionally difficult than she thought it would be to tell that story. Yeah. And, I mean, you guys all heard it, right? It was a pretty intense story. And so she sort of decided that this was not the right time or place for her to tell that story. And I fully supported her in that decision. So hopefully this week was a good inciting incident in her processing what she's been through. Having said that, how was it for you guys to work on your stories this week?
Awful.
Awful? Why, in what way?
Trying to share things in a way that's a little bit more abstract. And it's challenging because I feel like it's almost like too abstract. Like, are people going to get the message? And emotionally, I just found it so hard. It was really hard. Mm-hmm. I'm sure everybody feels like that, but
it's hard. Yeah. Yeah.
So no pressure. You guys can all help me.
Yeah. So it was like, yeah.
Mine came together pretty quick.
I know.
He
sent it to me the day after.
Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking about it the next day. All day, and then I just put it down on paper real quick.
I was sitting there being like, I have no idea what I've gotten myself into.
Yes.
The hardest part was actually when I read your reviews yesterday, because for me it was easy to say, like,
And then I felt sad. Mm-hmm. But then your bracket comments were like, tell me how you felt sad or like how you portrayed being sad. Mm-hmm. I was like, man, this is like, this is what the process of story writing is, not just like the saying, the general statement, which I felt mm-hmm. was way easier for me. So mm-hmm. As a consequence, my story is now way too long because I wrote like everything.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I felt sad was 4 words and now I've written a whole paragraph. So yeah. Anyways.
Yeah. That's great though, because using a word like sad, you know, it doesn't really describe anything, you know?
Hashtag
like
sad.
Yeah, hashtag sad.
Like big.
Yeah, what does that mean, yeah. Right?
I think as you move through your experience, it's like, get to the other side, get to the other side, next thing, at least for me it was. And so this was a time where I actually like thought it all the way through and like lived back in it instead of just like observing myself within it. Mm-hmm. Does that make,
yep.
I don't know mm-hmm. if I said that right.
I get it.
But it was like, I was back thinking through it all in a different way.
Kenzie,
yeah.
Hey.
Hi Kenzie.
How you doing?
I'm okay.
You're okay? All right, good. I'm glad you made it. So a couple things about the story circle. Remember, we're here to give feedback about the stories, not to give people advice about how to live their lives, right? So things to think about is, you know, what resonated with you in the story? Did any images come to mind as you were listening to the story? Or any questions that you have? So is there anyone who's brave enough to go first?
I'll go first.
Yeah? Awesome. All right. You ready, Harmony?
I'm ready.
Here we go.
Okay. January, a month of fresh starts, cold air, and resolutions.
Driving to my appointment as if it is any other doctor's visit, expecting to hear what I have heard before. All good. See you next time. I hit every red light along the way. I arrive at the hospital, and I find my way through the maze of offices and people. I land in the waiting room. My name is called, and I walk into a clean, sterile room with pamphlets and a binder of research. The desk was tidy and undisturbed. My doctor came in with a stack of papers and stoically announced that it is cancer. Cancer? That can't be right. But it is, and we need to move with speed. And decisions are made, surgery is arranged, medication is prescribed, injections, illness, sadness, all creep into my life. Treatment is set. I'm alone, I'm quiet, and I'm disturbed. Treatment day arrived, and again, I found myself hitting every red light along the way. This time, I move through the hospital with purpose and precision. I am met with a long hallway. I proceed with caution, and as I get closer, I see a sign. For the first time along my journey, I am met with the reality and enormity of it all. Stop. Stop traveling. Stop being a present mother. Stop plans to grow your family. Stop dreaming. Stop looking forward. Stop. Stop. I walk back to the nurse and ask, am I allowed to go past that barrier? Yes, you can. Those signs are for everyone else. I walk back to face the sign and fight my body from turning around and running away. Instead, I move beyond that sign, and I'm left alone to ingest radioactive iodine to kill any leftover cancer inside my body. I'm left in isolation to digest my experience fighting cancer. As I sit alone, I realize that I'm on the other side of that sign. I'm living with this reality, and no one can understand what it's like to be here, unless I tell them. The first few hours, I'm consumed by the thoughts of being sick, medicated, surgery, scars, isolation, sleepless nights, and tears. But as the hours pass and days come and go, I begin to understand that it has also given me the opportunity to open my heart, my thoughts, and my perception of what matters. There are days that are not so bad and ones that feel like they'll never end, but my cancer has a way of opening my eyes to view life differently and determine how I move forward. Sharing about my cancer experience is not about getting over it or leaving it behind, but rather accelerating, fighting, surviving, overcoming, and living my life without limitations because I saw the sign and I drove past it.
Wow.
Thank you.
Yeah. Nice story, hey? What stood out with to you guys in Harmony's story?
I love all the subtle references to travel and movement.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Remember we talked last time about sort of that visual image system that she was going to work with, about stopping mm-hmm. and going, and I think you can definitely hear it, how it's getting incorporated into the story that you're telling, which is awesome.
Great.
Yeah.
I'm wondering how easy it would be to find like a time lapse of a like traveling through a city.
Oh, yes.
And then like really fast, yeah. and then suddenly changing that to like an open road in the country.
I liked how you like cool, yeah. said stop like three times, because I was like, it was such a big moment then. Like I'm like, oh, it's like coming up the hill, and then you like fell down the other side. So
Story Mountain.
Yes, Story Mountain.
Nailed it.
Yeah. Cool. So who would like to go next?
I can go.
Yes, Eric.
We're all looking at
go.
You.
I can go.
Yes.
Pretty nervous, but I'd been a relatively healthy person my whole life, so it was a shock.
At times, the pain was so intense, I would lie. I would lie in my bed and sorry.
Beyond cancer, beyond surgeries, and beyond PTSD, I also lost my home, my family, my marriage, and every last crumb of worldly security.
There was a girl my age who relapsed twice while I was through treatment and ended up passing away when I finished my treatment with the same cancer as me, and
I needed to hear from friends and family. I needed time with my thoughts, and I needed to release my emotions. The end.
Wow. Ah, what a story.
It's so, weird. Yeah. I've read that like 8 times and then you say it out loud and you start to cry. Mm-hmm. It's funny, as you said your suggestions to other people, I'm like, maybe Bethany can give me some.
Well, I actually have like a really strong visual response to your story, and kind of like a mask situation.
Oh, that's really good. There was only like me or my mom that knew like the real version.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, the mask thing's awesome. Thank you.
I mean, one thing that really stood out to me as you were talking about your story is that sense that you didn't get closure that you were looking for, right? Because it sort of felt unfinished. Mm-hmm. And it made me think about that idea of moving forward versus moving on.
What actually happens for people who have cancer is that there is no end marker. You can choose to put markers, but
it doesn't really mean anything.
Yeah. Like you said, like doctors can't see every cell. Mm-hmm.
The conflict of moving forward versus moving on is like that healing versus curing. Mm-hmm. You're like choosing to heal even though you're not really cured. Or you might, I don't know, like doctors don't
know
if you are.
Yeah. Right.
But like you're choosing to still go forward.
Yeah.
Huh. Hey, not bad for not having anything written down.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I'm bad at the writing part. Like, I know what I want to say. I just putting it down is hard.
Okay. Well, yeah, we can work on that today.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So I try to.
Okay, so this word limit, is this like a hard, hard stop? Like, I'm just wondering, can someone come help me delete some stuff? Right, because writing on the nose again is when you say, like, you should tell, or you tell the person what to feel or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, you tell them exactly what you want them to learn from your story. Love it.
Okay.
528. That's pretty dang close. Yeah. I think you should just go with that. All right, awesome, Kelsey.
Thanks so much for helping me.
All right.
Kind of had it, I just don't know how to finish it.
I love how you said off guard, because it's sort of, you didn't realize it, but you had your guard up.
I since added that this morning.
Yeah, that's great. Cool. Great. You ready to record?
Yeah.
Okay.
I remember watching my sister's keeper with friends, laying in bed thinking about cancer, pediatric cancer, death. 2 months later, I was lying in the emergency department getting the same diagnosis. You have leukemia. Did I jinx it? I don't want to die.
10 days in the ICU, 5 bone marrow biopsies and aspirations, 5 spinal taps, 2 central lines, 6 months as an inpatient, 4 high-dose rounds of chemotherapy lasting 8 to 10 days, poison running through my veins, getting ready for the final treatment. Good news, protocols are changing. There's no added benefit of a 5th round. With those words, everything changed. After months of chemo, isolation, and preparation, there would be no transplant, no further treatment. After a moment of shocked silence in that familiar exam room, my oncologist explains that I wouldn't have survived another round. Your body is taking too long to recover. It's weak. No closure, no reassurance that you are cured, that you are in fact a survivor. Just new protocols, never-ending appointments, more experimental drugs to block infection, and uncertainty. I was assured they would watch me closely and that there's nothing to worry about. But that's easy to say. For the past 6 years, my blood counts have never recovered. A bad bruise, a cold, an infection, more symptoms. Every time I wonder, is this a relapse? Should I have done the transplant or that final chemotherapy treatment? It doesn't feel like I have, nothing to worry about. Cancer is always in the back of my mind, and slowly over time, I realize that I can't move on from cancer, but I can move forward. I am now a primary care paramedic, and I feel that I approach patients in a more compassionate way because I know what it is like to be them, to live with uncertainty. I also connect with other cancer survivors whenever I can and try to challenge myself physically and emotionally when I have the opportunity. Cancer will always be a part of my life. But I've learned that there's a difference between being cured and being healed.
Cool. That's a good ending.
I like to
do that. Yeah. Ending. Awesome. That's all the voiceovers, I think. I think we're good.
Nailed it.
Yeah.
So I want to do like a mask somehow over all of these. What kind of two?
Oh, yeah, they're a little creepy, aren't they? Yeah. It's not really what we're going for. Oh, wow, that one is really creepy. Oh, my gosh.
The theater masks, where like, yeah, like it's white with like one's
yeah, like this the one. Opera like this or something. One. Yeah. But I was, so I don't, I wanted to kind of like overlay that with like the smiling somehow.
With this one.
Yeah.
Mm. Okay. So basically you just drag the photo over top of the other one. And then what you can do is there's these new tools that show up and you can change the opacity like that. Right? Cool. And if you want people to feel overwhelmed, then put as many photos as you can in that section and then have them transition really quickly and people won't be able to follow.
Yeah, okay.
That's a great one.
So this has some hidden imagery right here because like this guy died of cancer and this guy committed suicide. So that's kind of, some people might understand that. What I was going through at that point, right?
Yeah.
Because it was the same year.
Being told I have cancer ended up all like black and white. And
yeah.
So I changed this one to be
black and white also.
Black and white.
Yeah. So, I mean, whenever you don't really know what to do, just think the images are there to help create a feeling.
Okay.
So what were you feeling in those moments?
Like. Hey guys.
Hey.
Sorry I'm tardy this morning.
Hey, no, that's all right. We just jumped right back into it.
Excellent.
Picking up where we left off.
Some other good news. I finally parked in the right place. Now that we're on the last day.
Yay! Found the parkade, all right. Generally, what we're hoping for the day to look like today, basically I'll do a tutorial right now. I'm looking at all the fancier video editing stuff. And pretty much it's free work time until lunch. And then after lunch, we'll do a quick check-in to make sure that people feel like they're going to be able to finish. And then we'll do our film screen at the end of the day.
Oh, yeah. That's so cool.
Yeah, I'm super stoked about this.
Yeah, so those are all your grandma's old photos?
Of her garden.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Like awesome. A very proper garden.
Yes.
Oh, I like this one.
I think what do you think? This could be cool.
I think it might be it. It's it?
Yeah, it's awesome.
Oh yeah, I like that.
Freaking awesome.
It's great.
I love it.
Whoa.
Yeah. Very cool. So what is the feeling you're trying to create?
Well, it's kind of like loneliness, I guess.
Yeah, the wilderness metaphor you can use in lots of different ways, right? You know, mm-hmm. It's the wilderness of your emotions type of thing, right? And then there's mm-hmm. the wilderness, you know, imagery that you're using throughout the whole thing. So let's just search that and see what we find.
13 months after getting married, 3 months after turning 30 years old, 2 months after buying our first home, and 1 month after getting a promotion at work, I was diagnosed with stage 4 Hodgkin's lymphoma. We got our first dog shortly after starting chemotherapy. Physically, I was doing good as I exercised regularly, went to a personal trainer, and emotionally, I appeared fine and thought I was. During one round of chemo at the hospital, I saw a flyer on the wall for a young adult cancer survivor's kayaking trip, and I instantly told my wife I'm going on that trip. I knew I would be done treatment in time for the trip, and it sounded like a fun adventure. Right after completing 6 months of treatment, I went back to work, and a month later received my scan results, which were inconclusive. But I guess I was considered a survivor. And within the week, I was off to the desert of Oregon. In the evenings, we told our cancer stories and wrote in journals. Telling my story to strangers helped me open up, but I could tell that something still didn't feel right. I was supposed to be a survivor and feel better about being done treatments. Why was I apprehensive? Why wasn't I happy? I cheated death. Day 7 of the 8-day trip, we were each left in a secluded stretch of river for 24 hours alone. There was no cell phones, no fishing allowed, just completely alone with my thoughts. I was left with an envelope and told to open it the following day. I thought the envelope had more writing tasks to enhance our journal entries, but when I opened the envelope, I realized it was letters from friends and family. I was completely caught off guard. Before I even had the chance to start reading, I was bawling my eyes out. It was a complete shock as I sat there reading the letters and crying. I realized that I had been bottling up my emotions since the very first day of diagnosis. It was an incredibly intense but happy cry as everything was released. I had a huge wave of endorphins flow through my body, and I've never felt better in my life. I felt free like nothing was holding me back anymore. I always tried to be strong, but really, I was just as scared as anyone with cancer. That trip helped me realize that I needed to hear from friends and family, but I also needed to be alone. I needed to be away from work. I needed to be in nature. I needed time with my thoughts. And I needed to let go of my emotions. Yeah, I mean, it could.
I think it could work.
Yeah.
And it ends with this.
Sorry. You're having a moment?
Is it perfect? You're having a moment?
So awesome.
It makes a big difference, doesn't it?
Yeah.
The music, it creates the feeling and it brings that emotional element to it, right?
Yeah. And it's, it stopped at a very, at a perfect point.
Yeah? Awesome. Okay.
Ooh, sorry, Darren.
So don't change that.
No, it's okay. It's okay.
All right, let's try this one. I think this will be a good one.
It's really sad.
Yeah. I kind of want to take it out. It seems too, vulnerable, but I'm just going to leave it.
Yeah, I mean, that's a decision you can make towards the end if you want to, right? Because, it does have, it creates a visceral feeling as you're watching it,
So, there's a couple things you wanted to do, right?
Yeah, so.
So which ones are moving too quickly?
These ones.
I would maybe.
Bye.
Yeah, I would maybe delete those, yeah.
Bye, right? Felicia.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I love this part.
That is pretty funny.
It's so funny. I just love all the way the elements are coming together.
Do you feel tired at all?
I don't know. I was definitely getting emotional.
As you're watching it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like every time you watch it?
No, not every time, but certain parts.
Yeah.
Yesterday evening,
Like, I was feeling just, like, really, really spent.
Mm-hmm.
And because you're editing the first part of your video, which is, like, going through the tough stuff part, mm-hmm. and you know you keep re-listening it.
Huh.
Like, it kind of reopens the wound or, like, keeps, like, picking at it. But today, you get to go to the end where it's like, and then I came through, and I'm like, yeah!
Your yeah. voice isn't nearly as annoying as it was yesterday?
Yeah. Not at all.
This is the end scene, and kind of want to represent like a rebaptism kind mm-hmm. of thing, okay? Nobody's gonna get this at all, but that's okay.
It's all right, it's your story.
Plug
right?
in.
So, you could pick a photo that sort of represents darkest hour.
Yeah, that's good, instead yeah. of like speaking directly to like, my mom was holding me.
Yeah, exactly, right? Because that's the okay. feeling, right? Was this new day yeah. is dawning.
Sweet, thank
awesome.
You.
Awesome, cool.
I'm almost Great, done, Kelsey. Maybe.
That's awesome.
Maybe technical difficulties.
Yeah, sure.
Do you just want to watch everyone else's?
Yeah, desperately.
Like, I'm like, just wanting to know so bad.
It's beautiful.
No, I'm not even playing anything.
I just want to know so bad. Like, what's everyone else's doing?
All right.
Oh.
Especially the music.
So hopefully by now you guys all realize how incredible it is to make one of these stories.
Yes.
So there's really only one rule for the film screening. And that is mandatory standing ovation
oh.
for everyone.
Love it.
So at the end of everyone's story, we give them a standing ovation, and then we'll have a chance to chat about it a little bit afterwards. So, cool. feeling a little nervous?
I feel nauseated a little bit.
No.
So here we go. Harmony's story, everybody.
And stoically announced that it is cancer. Cancer? That can't be right, but it is. And we need to move with speed. Everything changes because I saw the sign and I drove past it.
Yeah! Yay! Yeah! Awesome! Wow! Yes!
Thank you.
That was awesome! Sweet. So cool!
Love that sound at the end.
Yeah. That was a random truck passing on the highway that we caught by accident on the
So microphone. Good.
Yeah. So yeah, what resonated with you guys in Harmony's story?
Really loved the way that you just stopped the music. It was very dramatic.
Again, a mistake.
Yeah.
What,
another,
really?
Another mistake, yeah.
Just the silence, I really like that.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah.
That's what I was hitting Mike about when he was working with Derek. I was like, Mike, Mike! That was it, because it just stopped. And
oh, okay.
I don't know if I would have thought cool.
to do
that.
Yeah, I like that.
I don't know if that's a stock photo or if that's actually...
Yeah, it is a stock photo.
But it was just, yeah, it was just like everything's dark and there's just like one person facing this wall, which is like metaphorically like facing everything.
Right.
So, yeah. I liked that part.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a good image. Yeah. Cool. All right, one more for Harmony.
Thank you. Thank you for your help.
Yeah, that was
Thank
awesome.
You for your support.
Great. Okay. All right. Is there anyone who would like to go next? Yeah. All right, Bethany. Cool. All right. Yeah.
Wow.
I don't know how you put that together in like 2 days. That's amazing.
Yeah.
It kind of felt, because it was all always moving, like a memory.
Yeah.
It was like you were having this memory of those things happening. It was cool. really nice. I liked that part.
Never even thought of that, but yeah. Okay, cool.
Yeah, Derek! Yeah! Awesome, yeah! Ooh.
That was so good. I loved the music. It really like, fit your theme.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Really loved the panning out of your view with the images of the family.
It always seemed like people didn't really seem like it was that good of a story, but to me it was like so profound that it just like I would tell it to people, but it's hard to explain it in words.
That was great.
So wow.
Yeah. Awesome.
I love the way that came together.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah. You could feel the hurry up get better and then at the end really realizing that there is a big difference for that healing, right? What it feels like to be or what it Yeah. Yeah. It was beautiful.
So good. Wow. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. How are you feeling, Kelsey? You ready?
Yep.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Cool. Awesome. Here we go. Kelsey's story, everyone.
Your doctor will be right with you. As I walk to the waiting room, I think about how many times I had heard those words in my life living with an autoimmune disease. But this appointment felt different. I'd been having pain in my neck for a while that I had tried to ignore. The last thing I wanted was another appointment, but I finally accepted defeat and figured I'd better come and get it checked out. "What are you in for this time?" my doctor jokes as he comes in and closes the door. I describe the pain as he examines my neck. "It is most likely a strained muscle. You should go see a massage therapist." It didn't feel like a strained muscle, but smiling and nodding, I promised to go soon. That interaction became a consistent routine in my life. Many referrals, many tests and specialists, and ultimately many non-answers. The pain was becoming more severe, but I smiled harder to make sure people thought nothing was wrong. I refused pain medication, and I continued to tell people that everything was all right. The pain, which originally started on the left side of my neck, morphed to the entire left side of my face, jaw, and neck. At times, the pain was so intense, I would lie in my bed and silently cry, wetting an entire pillow with tears. Each night as I fell asleep, I would hope that it would magically be gone in the morning. I kept pushing forward, because if I let the pain stop me, then I wouldn't be successful. I would fall behind, be a failure. I was once again sitting in the clinic waiting for my doctor. I felt hopeless. I didn't want to be there, but more than anything, I just wanted to be able to say, "I'm doing good," and really mean it. Suddenly, my phone rang. The voice on the other end was an oncologist. I had never met him before. He took a deep breath and said, "I have been sent your biopsy results that confirm the mass in your neck is salivary gland cancer." I couldn't breathe. Cancer? A week later, I crawled into my mom's bed and let her hold me. As I cried, I said I didn't want to die. I told her I was afraid of the future and angry about the past. I was grieving the life I thought I was going to have. The next morning, despite the looming surgery, I started to feel lighter and happier than I had in months. It felt backwards. I thought that if I could force myself to be happy, that I would eventually get there. But allowing myself to be honest with my mom about how shitty I felt was the breakthrough I needed. I still have days where I'm fearful about cancer, but I no longer ignore it. I say it loud and proud, and despite the fear, now I can really smile.
Yeah, all right, Kelsey, yes. Yeah, that was awesome. So what stood out to you guys in Kelsey's story?
Wow. There was a lot.
Yeah, there was a lot for Harmony, yeah. Yeah.
Wow. I like the part where you had the flashing, the smiles, and it got like faster and faster and faster.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, yeah. Like you were stuck in this like routine of just smiling through it.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It worked.
Yeah, I was going to say, thanks guys. That's like exactly, because it was hard. How do you kind of do a conversation in pictures? So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, especially seeing you crying.
Mm. Whoa.
It said to Mike, I said, I don't want to put it in. Because it like seemed really vulnerable, and it's kind of weird. Why was I selfieing myself crying? But before we had it like two separate things, and he said maybe you should just overlay it. Hmm. And in a way, that kind of made me feel better because it wasn't just on its own. It didn't feel as vulnerable, but then also it kind of showed like the smiling part. But then also, I guess like what we all feel inside, even though we don't show it outwardly. So.
Yeah.
All our stories. you know, there's physical aspects, and it's what we talk about when we go to the doctor, but, you know, it's the emotional stuff that we don't really talk about, and
yeah.
It's a good way to talk about it and show it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Well, the cool thing is we will actually get to see what it's like for people to watch these stories, because we all get to invite some people to a screening.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to be really neat to hear what they have to say about it.
Dumb question. Like, we're good at the feedback. Well, I think we're good at it. Like, how about if no one talks in the audience?
How are you?
Good.
This is my husband, Sean.
Yeah.
Sean, this
nice
is Mike.
Nice to meet you, Sean.
Cool. And this is Molly.
Good to see your photo. Molly.
Yeah,
hi, Molly.
You've seen them, right? I guess, yeah.
Who's this?
Kayla.
Kayla, nice to meet you. Friend? All right.
Yes.
Awesome,
yes.
Cool.
That's my friend, Wendy.
Hi, Wendy. I'm Mike.
Mike.
Nice
Mike.
To meet you. Nice to meet you, Steve. Nice thanks for you. Coming. Cool.
Glean.
Glean, nice to meet you. And Grandma. Awesome.
Aunt.
Cool, great, nice to meet you.
And then?
And Mark.
Yeah, you look familiar. I recognize you from a photo or two.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Cool.
This is Jen.
Hi, Jen, nice to meet you.
Hi, nice
cool,
to meet you.
Thanks for coming. Come on in.
I have
come
one other
in.
Guest coming, but they're not here yet. So.
Okay, we'll yeah, no problem.
They're probably like,
well, yeah, we have some pictures. So, yeah, grab a snack or a drink. Thank you all for being here and being a part of this discussion. Yeah, there's six of us in this room that got to spend a weekend together creating little mini movies about our cancer experience called Digital Stories. And today we're going to get to watch those stories and have little conversations about it. So without further ado, our first story. Kelsey! Oh. Yeah! So when me and Kelsey first connected, she's like, I don't even know if I have a story to share.
Yeah.
But yeah, here we go. Kelsey's story.
Your doctor will be right with you. As I walk to the waiting room, I think about how many times I had heard those words in my life.
In the evenings, we told our cancer stories and wrote in journals. Telling my story to strangers helped me open up.
There are days that are not so bad and ones that feel like they'll never end.
But I've learned there's a difference between being cured and being healed.
There we go, Kelsey's story. Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Cool. So we're gonna give you guys a chance to chat with each other about this story. So just turn to the person next to you and share one thing that resonated with you in that story.
It's my pants. It's hard. She's done everything she needs to do.
You got the diagnosis and it was like, stop, everything stops. It sounds like what you said to that was no. It doesn't
thank
stop.
You.
It just changed.
Yeah. This is something that I never thought.
Why don't we talk about it? But we're all like that. None of us. It's like we don't want to talk about it. It's the elephant in the room.
Well, especially men.
Especially men, yeah.
Because it is emotional.
So yeah, is there anyone who's be willing to share one thing that you talked about with the person next to you? Yeah.
The reminder that once you're able to share a fear or a situation with somebody, it makes it easier to carry that burden because you have somebody to share it with.
Yeah,
as opposed to
share it
holding
with.
It inside.
Yeah.
Husband and our baby kind of in that last frame of that's what's important. And
yeah.
Just, you know, the clarity around what in life is important. And mm-hmm.
Somebody sat him down and said, here, read this. Mm-hmm. And then he sort of went, oh my God, okay, I'm not in this alone. I'm not doing this by myself.
Hanging out with all our friends, everyone would say, well, you look great. You look mm-hmm. good. And I think I knew she was smiling, but not from the inside. And she mm-hmm. had this front for a while and she was so strong, and now just being able to see her smile and know she's really smiling it from the inside as well, it's really nice to see.
And you mm-hmm. can start to see the pattern in both stories that they have to dig in deep and find that resiliency to carry on, and they, for her, she brings that into healthcare. Mm-hmm. And you know, compassion is a lot of thing, is an important element we're missing in healthcare because we get so carried away by the process of it.
Yeah. Maybe we could have even called today's screening Stories of Resilience, because I think yeah. that's really what you see.
And what does sick even look like? That's something I've learned, to never judge mm-hmm. anyone, because even if we pulled this room and we had to pick out the five people or six that were sick,
we couldn't, because you can't, and you don't know what's going on with anybody, and that is true. People would say, oh, she looks fine to me, mm-hmm. but what does sickness look like? Well, that's what sickness looks like.
Yeah. So you sometimes don't. Sometimes it looks like a smile.
Oh, well, yeah. He looks damn good, right? Yeah.
It looks good. Yeah. Come on. One more for Derek.
Yeah.
Cool. All right, so our next story, Bethany, yeah. So I think when we watched our story as a group, I think, Bethany, you know, you said you were a little nervous because I think you even used the words artsy-fartsy or something like that. And, you know, every story is so unique, that's what makes them awesome. So yeah, here's Bethany's story.
My cancer story is about love.
I grew up surrounded by the kind of love that looks good, like a comfortable, sensible outfit that makes you look like you belong, on trend and always sending the right message. The kind of love that isn't too much, and it certainly doesn't make you look like you're trying too hard. This love wasn't a fit for me. I was diagnosed with cancer at age 23. Here, a garden grew around me, wild and untamed and unruly, as the roots of my sorrow tapped into love itself. Comfortable and sensible was slowly replaced with bright fragrance of acceptance, playfulness, passion, joy, boldness, wholeness, desire, and confidence. Child of the sun, while I am here with you, I will pour every ounce of love I have into your sweet, perfect person. Dearest companion, I desire the wholeness of you. Without fear, I take your hand and choose to go on this mysterious journey with all of you. Humanity, I see you and I feel your joy. I will love you without judgment. While you are here, you are deserving of unconditional love. Friends, we have become family. You will know that I love you. I will show you love. I will show you the ways that you are beautiful and remain by your side when your beauty is hidden. My arms will be open for you always. Beautiful body, you will be broken, dismantled, and put back together again. I will never hide your scars. While I have you, I will love you and celebrate you just as you are. To my mind, you are exquisitely different and unique. I will love you by nurturing your desires, satisfying your creativity, indulging in your curiosity. I remained in this garden for 10 years as the anniversary that would close the door on my cancer story approached. As the garden grew around me, I experienced more loss than I thought possible. I lost more than time, more than freedom, and more than pieces of my body. Wilder wildness grew over me and enveloped all remaining pieces of my former life. I lost all visions of how my life would unfold. Now all that remains is me in my garden, wearing radiant and wild love. Gentle, pure spirit, you are without fault. You are loved by love itself. In this garden, love is the highest power, and love itself is your calling. This love is the reason you have life.
Here we go. Bethany's story, yeah.
Cool. Every time I watch it again, you know, you find more and more things. Like, I liked how you talk to your soul at the end. Because at the end of everything, like, your soul is who you are. And so there's all these other pieces.
You know, the garden is a great analogy. And over time, you could see that the vines were this, but now it's something else. And she's got the sun there and changed her dress. And,
yeah. See, it makes sense to everyone. Yay.
Felt so weird at the time.
I thought it was like a poem. It was beautiful the way you relate your story in such an analogous way that,
Yeah, you could see the growth and the transformation that you took on your journey.
Thank you.
And how you relayed it was beautiful. You're a writer.
Yeah, it's very poetic.
Yeah.
I think the amount of gratitude she has as well, and for not only people, but her body, whereas I think a lot of people would have, and maybe she did at some point, was very angry at her body, but to say now that she's very thankful for it really, really struck me, and that's really amazing.
Yeah.
So there might have been something else later on in life that sort of made her become who she's become, but it's very hard to kind of take away this experience and not see that this is a big part of who she is.
Really appreciate all of you being here, being a part of this screening. And we like to end with one thing that we've ended every day with. And we'll just go around and say one word about how you're feeling right now. And whoever starts gets to choose which direction we go.
Blessed.
Blessed.
Yes.
All right, which way are we going?
Sean.
I'll go proud.
Proud, cool.
Informed.
Thankful.
Fortunate.
Hopeful.
Enlightened.
Grateful.
Inspired.
Happy.
Grateful.
Yeah, inspired.
Aware.
Empowered.
Involved.
Happy.
Grateful, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, my word is thankful. Thank you for being here. I think now is probably a good time for the standing ovation for everyone.
Yay!
Yes! Yeah! Yes, take a bow. Take a bow.
Cool. I don't even know the word. I don't want to say like important, but that's almost what it felt like. Maybe it's not a story worth telling, which is super sad now that I think about it, right? Like, but those were that's how I felt coming in.
Once you kind of got us thinking about moments, I start to feel like, oh, I have like quite a few moments I could start writing about without having to think too hard.
I mean, I talk about it, but I don't necessarily talk about this intense portion of it, you know? I'm more like, oh, I did this when I was in treatment, isn't that cool?
Put a story out there because that's a marker for where you're at. I didn't have a marker up until that, so.
I do think it changed a little bit. I refined it and was able to put my thoughts better together and what I actually wanted to say.
Kind of a little apprehensive about showing it, but I think obviously, you know, it was good. Like, it was a great experience.
I think I was still like expecting positive feedback, but I guess not so insightful or like meaningful feedback.
Like, hey, they got it. Like, mm-hmm. What I was trying to say for once, someone finally understood.
Great.
Great experience.
Well, you did it.
I
all
did
right.
It.
Yeah, you made it to the end.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay.
Cool.
That's it. That's a wrap, boys.
That's a wrap.
Beers? Beers o'clock?
Yeah, beers o'clock. Amanda, it's good
hey,
to see you.
Good to see you.
Good. And look at the little girl.
Yes, you got a bit of an update from the last time we spoke.
Yeah. So what's her name?
Her name is Gabriella, and she is 2 months old.
Awesome. Yeah. That's amazing. I believe we could move the mountain.
There we have it. There is the documentary film that took such a labor of love and worked out so well. As I said at the beginning, folks, I'd invite you to throw your questions into the Q&A or the chat. We can manage both.
And before we launch, well, you can do that while simultaneously while I'm talking. I just thought I wanted to reintroduce who you're kind of talking to now, who you can direct questions to and who I can sort the questions out with. Certainly, obviously, the man of the hour is Mike Laing. So I am Mike's supervisor. Again, I'm Dr. Catherine Laing, and I am an associate professor in the Faculty of Nursing, and I'm also the associate dean of undergrad. And then Dr. Nancy Moles is, her camera's on there, you can see her. She is a full professor in the Faculty of Nursing. Many of you on the call here would know her. And she's also the Associate Dean Research in our faculty. And then Dr. Deborah McLeod hails to us all the way from Halifax, Nova Scotia. She is an advanced practice nurse and a registered couple and family therapist. And she also holds adjunct appointments with Dalhousie University and our university, our Faculty of Nursing. So that's the panel that we're working with. And I see that we've got some comments coming in, Mike. But I thought to start us off, could you provide a little more context, Mike, about how this turned into your data? Like this is, I don't think that maybe a lot of people quite understood that. And I know we have some PhD students on the call here. So this is a very unique project. Maybe you could just spend a moment or two contextualizing that a bit more.
Yeah. You know, I think it's pretty clear through the film that, you know, digital storytelling, it has a form, but it doesn't have a formula. And so it's, you can't sort of approach it with a formulaic research approach. And so that's what drew me to hermeneutics, because, you know, in hermeneutics, you know, the way that you pursue the understanding of the topic is somewhat influenced by the topic itself, what you're looking at. And so for me, you know, that sort of fluid, flexible approach, but also very rigorous in the way that you sort of look at data, was what sort of made me think, okay, maybe a film could actually be seen as data, as something that you could analyze and interpret. And then of course, meeting with you and Nancy, and you guys saying yes, and Deb, I remember sitting in the room when you guys said, yeah, let's do it. I was like, are you kidding me? I loved it. And so, you know, but I think hermeneutics is what sort of, you know, it's the research methodology, the approach that allowed something like a film to be viewed as data. And I think for, you know, the students out there looking at maybe different ways of data collection, different styles or types of data collection, hermeneutics is really flexible in that way, and allows you sort of explore a topic in the way that it should be explored in a way. If I tried to use a very, you know, rigid research methodology to look at digital storytelling, I doubt that I would have gotten to the depth of understanding that I feel like I was able to by filming it. And when you actually, you know, last thing is, you know, when you read a lot of digital storytelling research, you know, there's lots of people, they're reflecting back on their experience. So they're not like living it in the moment. And what I really wanted to see was, you know, what were people going through? How could we understand their experiences in the moment? And, you know, it was always so hard to explain to people what I did with digital storytelling. And I feel like you could read 20 research papers or you could watch the film, and watching the film will give you, a much deeper understanding of what actually digital storytelling is and the process that people go through. It's hard sometimes to articulate things in words alone. And Derek is a perfect example of that. He didn't have the words, but he did have the images and the music and the voiceover. He could put it all together to help people really understand his experience, ultimately for the first time, I think. So I don't know if that helps much, but, you know, I would say, you know, without getting too deep into the sort of hermeneutic methodology, you know, that's sort of where I came from, using that as data. Yeah.
Thank you. We have a few questions that are coming in. Bonnie would like to know, are these digital stories going to be shared broadly?
Yes, they are already. They're up on the Mike Laing Stories YouTube channel, and we've done lots of screenings. We've done screenings with Wellspring Calgary and Young Adult Cancer Canada. We've got a full slate of film screenings coming up in 2022. And so, yeah, they'll be shared broadly in the context of the film itself. The individual digital stories we haven't actually shared yet. But they'll be available eventually. Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Another question, Mike, from Kate. Mike, thank you for sharing this with us. I think it's the third time I've seen it and it's more beautiful every time. I have a question about Bethany's story. She was worried that people wouldn't get it, but it seemed to me that her metaphors were able to hold her story in a different way than just saying it outright might have. I wonder if you can speak to that.
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, and Bethany's experience was what I think one of the was an interpretation that really sort of was something that I learned in a new, deeper way. And I called one of the interpretations the unsayable, accessing aquifers of meaning through digital storytelling. And it comes from a guy, Nicholas Davey, and he talks about how artworks can act as sort of artesian wells that tap into these deeper layers of meaning that sort of are underneath the surface of experience, and they just let them flow to the surface under natural pressure to have these things come out. And I sort of use that to talk about the said, the unsaid, and the unsayable. And in Bethany's experience, you know, there were things that people didn't understand about her story. It was very layered. There were many layers of meaning in her story, but they understood something. And I think that's what I loved about her experiences. People interpreted it in all sorts of different ways that she never intended. Even it had a specific meaning in her mind, but the way people viewed it, the pair of glasses they brought to interpret it were different. And that didn't make any of those interpretations any less valid or any less meaningful for people. And you heard Bethany say it a number of times. She's like, oh, I didn't think of that. And when you create a really good story that's well told, that's what is the power of a good story well told, is that people are able to take pieces of wisdom that then they can apply to their own lives in ways that you may never have expected. And so, yeah, I don't know if that I speak to that enough, but, you know, there's things that are that can't be said. They're unsayable. And a good artwork are able to sort of tap into some of those things and bring them to the surface of our awareness and experience.
Mike, I have a multifaceted question for you.
Oh, okay.
this is an atypical research project, and you had to be very, you had to navigate ethics very carefully in terms of how, because obviously anonymity is not possible here. And then we saw with Amanda at the beginning. Can you speak a little bit about that piece of it and how you navigated that so delicately? And also, you know, the challenge that you get quite frequently about, and we heard, I think it was Kelsey say it before, like, this is so emotionally hard. And so the challenge that you get, well, are you doing more damage by bringing these up with people? Can you talk to that a little bit?
Yeah. You know, it's interesting after spending thousands of hours with young adult cancer survivors, my answer to that is, you know, it is no more ethically damaging than Amanda seeing a birth announcement on Instagram. Right. You know, people experience these things every day. Right. We sometimes worry that we have this paternalistic worry, I guess, that we're causing damage by having people think about these experiences, but it's their life. It's what's happened to them. Every time Amanda goes on Instagram and sees another birth announcement, having just had to, you know, abort a baby she wanted, you know, she is, you know, she has that trauma. And so the difference between everyday life, where you get sort of these experiences, and a digital storytelling workshop, is that you actually are helping them story those traumatic experiences, and actually in a very short amount of time can put a bit of a, I call it an ellipsis ending on a very difficult experience. And so the biggest part about caring well for people, and this is what Amanda's interpretive chapter is all about, is we called it wound care. And it's about how to care well for people, because you may never know if they're in the midst of their trauma when they show up for a workshop. So there's has to be lots of things in place. The first one is giving them lots of opportunities to step out once they realize maybe this isn't the right time or place for the story. The second one is having, you know, psychosocial professionals on call, like we did. And I talked about the phone number, and she ended up actually connecting with the psychologist she had been working with before. You know, having those in place, and then also giving them the opportunity to change the story. Maybe the abortion story wasn't the right one for her to tell in that moment, but she could have told a different one. So anyways, those are the three things that I sort of did to try and care well for her. And the fact that she still wanted to be in the film, despite not completing the research project, I think shows that we did care well for her. And then that final video at the end, you know, I hadn't seen her in 8 months or nine, no, it was a year, sorry. And I called her up and I said, Amanda, we're going to watch the film together. And she said, oh yeah, I've got an update for you. And here she was with a child that she got pregnant with right after she
backed out of the study. So anyways, that was, I would say, for the ethical practice of it, there's a lot of things that you need to be aware of. And I talk about that a lot in the thesis. For like the REB stuff, I would just say we use something called continual consent. So we actually sort of created a new sort of consenting process specifically for this project. And it required a lot of description and a lot of sort of work to make sure that it was understood what we were doing and all that stuff in the ethics review process. But yeah, I can talk more about that later. I think I've talked enough though.
Great. I'd like to invite the panelists in now, Nancy and Deb. Maybe just to start off, Nancy and Deb, could you speak to your experience being on the supervisory committee, helping to supervise a thesis in a unique project like this, and maybe lessons learned along the way and you know, maybe cautionary tales for others too?
Absolutely. First of all, I just want to start by saying my congratulations to Mike, Dr. Laing, and to Dr. Laing, his supervisor, for work beautifully done. One of the things that really has struck me throughout this whole process has been the way that Mike was able to marry the fact that he was a skilled and he loves doing documentaries and he's really skilled at it, that he was able to marry that with his love of hermeneutics and bring them together, I think was incredibly creative and really just sort of sets the bar for thesis, I think. And approaching research in a original way, as in treating a documentary as data, which I just love. One of the reflections that I had as I was watching this again was I think maybe one of the challenges that we had, probably mostly you, Catherine, as supervisor, but us as a supervisory committee, was, and Mike too, how do we not just sort of move into looking at the documentary and analyzing it as a literary critique, right? And not just saying, okay, so here's what the documentary did and here's what we did in this process, but more about what data exists in the documentary that actually teaches us something about the topic. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of bringing the topic back, which was the experiences of storing cancer, young adult cancer survivorship. And so I think it was always the juggling, balancing and discernment about not getting absorbed into the documentary, but thinking of how the documentary can inform the interpretations that you came up with. And I think, once again, it was beautifully done. So that's all I have to offer at this point. I'll turn it to Deb.
Well, I think you said it very well, Nancy. I think it was a very much of a juggling act. And there's so many layers of what you accomplished in that thesis, Mike, that I actually don't think the thesis melted all out yet. So there's probably lots of papers to come.
Yes.
But I think watching this, not so much about my experience. I think Nancy said that as a supervisory committee, kudos to Catherine, because I think there was a way in which it was a bit of a risky project. How were we going to make this work in a way that, but I think you did, Mike. I think you really accomplished something solid and very interesting on so many different levels. It's going to make a really nice contribution. I think the thing that struck me watching the film again, and someone I think in the comments said it, every time I see it, I think of other aspects to it. But I think, who was it that said it at the end? This was a marker for where I'm at, and I didn't have a marker. Mm-hmm. I think that's a very profound, even kind of prophetic message about what it's like to have cancer, but particularly what it's like to be a young adult with cancer, because it's just so very difficult to come up with a cohesive story about the experience. And we know that that's how people heal, is they create stories about what happened to them. Mm-hmm. But in the absence of having the creativity of the digital story processing, it's so much more difficult. It was said in many different ways. How do I get this into words? Well, there's many ways in which it was not sayable exactly for all of them. I do want to make that point, though, about trauma and the core dynamic in PTSD is avoidance of the experience. And so the more that one is supported to approach the experience and talk about it rather than avoid it and bury it, the less likely people are going to be move into PTSD or continue to carry the trauma. So it's a profoundly healing process, I think, for all of those people. And one that likely, be interesting, you won't probably, except informally, but to talk with them for a year from now, because this is kind of an experience. It's like throwing a pebble in a pond, right? There's ripples. And so we won't really know, they won't really know how it's going to unfold for some time, but it's that kind of an experience. So yeah, I enjoyed the experience of working with you on it, Mike, very much, and Catherine and Nancy. I think it's a fine contribution.
Excellent. Mike, there's a question from David that I'm going to pull just part of it out because it does sort of relate to what we were just talking about earlier. And so the part that I'm going to tease out here is, are the results of this research and methodology intertwined? Can you speak to how you made that happen? Because this was your data that ultimately became a 300 and some odd page thesis. And so how did you do that? Can you speak to that?
Yeah, it's really interesting you picked up on that, David, because in the thesis, I actually wrote three little chapters that I called interludes that were not directly related, but peripherally related to the research topic. And one of those was looking at sort of the parallels in a way between a hermeneutic approach to research and a hermeneutic approach to digital storytelling. And this is sort of the interesting thing. As I was writing even my lit review, it's the ideas, the tenets of philosophical hermeneutics, like the hermeneutic circle, the address, hermeneutical aesthetics, all these different pieces of philosophy that help you sort of understand how to do practice hermeneutic research, also helped me become a better digital storytelling facilitator at the same time. They helped me understand what was happening for people as they were sitting there, finding meaningful moments, reflecting on what those meant, and sort of stitching together these stories. And so yes, I would say, the results and the methodology definitely were so connected. I think much more than I ever realized was going to be the case going into it, because you sort of learn your methodology and then you try to do it, apply it. And as I was learning it, I was learning how to become a better digital storytelling facilitator at the same time, which is then I was applying that as well. So in my thesis, I try and sort of tease out those distinctions, but ultimately, the philosophy not just helped me do research, it changed who I am. And I think Nancy has a really great example of that in a phrase she says, it seeps into your bones. And I think once you have a good understanding of hermeneutic philosophy, it really does change the way that you interact with the world. And for me, it changed the way that I interacted with digital storytelling as a facilitator. So yeah, I don't know if exactly that's what you're asking, but the results and the methodology are definitely entwined. As I was writing the interpretations of in my thesis from the film, I used a lot of hermeneutic philosophy to help in those interpretations, to help me understand and help hopefully the reader understand what's happening for people on the screen.
Eva, we can send you Mike's 300 page thesis to read.
Yes.
Coming your way soon. Mike, there's a few logistical types of questions in the chat for you.
Yeah.
How long did it take for the participants in the documentary to make their digital stories? I heard you say in the doc that you spent all weekend together.
Yeah.
Were all these put together over the course of the weekend, or was it more than that?
Yeah, so we did a 3-hour introduction to digital storytelling workshop where people found their moments. That was the first 7 minutes of the film. And then they actually wrote their voiceover at home, and they emailed it to me, and I sort of made revisions using track changes to send it back to them. So then they came to the weekend with a pretty solid voiceover draft. And then they also came with images that they thought they could use to illustrate that. And you saw most of them had their own computers in addition to the editing computer. And so, they made those stories essentially in that 3-hour workshop and then the weekend together. That's, it doesn't always sometimes it could take longer, it could take shorter, but as a workshop format, I found that works really well. Because it's easier for people to commit to a weekend than you know, a longer, like 3 days, for example. Or sometimes it's even easier to do it just all at once in a weekend versus spreading it out in evenings throughout a month. But I've done many different styles of digital storytelling workshops, and all of them, you know, as long as you do the, in my thesis, I talk about the four phases. You know, we actually, Catherine and Nancy and I wrote a research paper, or sorry, methodology paper about it. But, you know, you finding the moments, telling the story, crafting the story, and then sharing the story. As long as you do those four things, the logistics of how you do it, I think, can be endlessly modified to suit the population you work with.
Another question here from Eleanor, who works in health research and patient partners, and we talk about using storytelling in research, but no one is willing to tackle getting started. Where would you recommend we start?
Using stories in research? Oh man, I think Nancy and Deb probably have a bit to add to this as well. But I would say, you know, it all depends on having a good match with the methodology that you're looking at, right? And there's lots of different storytelling sort of research methodologies. Digital storytelling in particular is great because it has a built-in KT function, right? You have these stories that you can learn from, but also then you can share those with everyone else so that they can learn from them as well. So I would say, you know, finding the right group of people, honestly, was what I would say. You got to have the right group of people who are willing to take that step, like Nancy and Deb and Catherine. And I didn't mention this at the beginning, but Catherine, you know, we did a research project together beforehand. And so maybe that's a good way to start. Start something small before you jump into a full-on documentary and a thesis, right? So maybe just try a couple small projects with some people and see what happens. But yeah, I don't know, Nancy and Deb, you probably have more to say there.
No, that's good.
Okay.
And although I was going to add that I think Mike's services might be out for hire. I'm not sure.
Yes.
You can speak more to that. There's a question there from Kate Wong asking, what's next for you, Dr. Laing?
Yeah, well, you know, as I was doing this project, I was doing lots of other digital storytelling stuff as well. And so I started a small business called Mike Laing Stories, where I do a lot of film stuff and digital storytelling projects all over North America. And I also started one called Common Language Digital Storytelling, where I'm training other digital storytelling facilitators. And we just wrapped up another one of those. And so that now there's 22 people who've gone through the level one training for digital storytelling. And they're doing amazing projects in all sorts of different fields in health, mostly in health and wellness. And it's really exciting to see being able to take some of the stuff that I learned through working with Catherine and Essie and Deb and sharing it with others through common language. So yeah, that's what's next for me, I guess. Lots more digital storytelling and a few film projects as well. So yeah, maybe a postdoc, who knows?
Mike Benjamin is asking, what is the inspiration behind the movie title?
Emerging Horizons. You know, you're the first person to ask me that, Benjamin. I would say, you know, it came from this idea. Horizons, the horizon of understanding is something that you hear in hermeneutic philosophy a lot, is your horizon. They sort of, it's the equivalent of your pair of glasses, you know, what you can currently see through, you know, whatever, you know, that your angle of commitment, I guess, what you can see. And so for me, what I really liked about digital storytelling and through the whole process is how things emerged from the process that most people didn't know. Everyone told a story that was different than they thought they were going to tell. So there's that process of things emerging from the stories and experiences of our life and the deep wisdom that's embedded in that. And then there's also this idea of merging. So these things emerge, and then through the group process, they merge together into these new stories, you know, and Kenzie's story is a great example of that, you know, being cured versus being healed. That wasn't her words. That came from someone else, but it was something that really characterized her experience at such a deep level. She chose those words in her story. So they merged together. And then finally, through that process, I think everyone's horizon of understanding expanded as a research, but also in the workshop itself. You know, we all came away from that with a much deeper understanding of the cancer experience, of our personal cancer experiences, but also, I would say, just life in general. And you saw that in the friends and family screening. People are pulling out all these things. You know, they've never had cancer, but there's that one young woman who said, you know, I appreciate how you, I like how you said you were thankful for your body. You know, body image is a universal, you know, that we can all pull from a story about cancer that may be relevant to us. And so anyways, the whole idea of new understanding, emerging things, merging together, and then the expanding horizons that sort of resulted from that. That's sort of what I was thinking. But often I usually don't answer. I just sort of say, well, what do you think it means? And that usually has a better response than what I came up with. So, yeah.
Thank you. We're getting to the end here. I think we have time maybe for two more questions. Mary is asking, saying that the stories touched her deeply. Might you be doing this again with another group? I would be interested.
Yeah. I'm doing it one just like this. It's going to be short. We're not going to watch the whole film, but with the Canadian Association of Psychosocial Oncology on January 27th. I don't know if that's open to the public, but if you like watching stories and talking about them, every Thursday, the third Thursday of every month with Wellspring Calgary, we watch digital stories and then we talk about them as a group. And it's amazing, actually, you know, the things that we learn. And you know, there's 800 stories I've made. So I just bring in storytellers from all over and we watch those. So if you go to wellspringcalgary.ca, you can watch some stories, sometimes about cancer, sometimes about other things, and then be part of a discussion about them. And those nights I learned so much from. They're amazing. Also, through Common Language, we do something quarterly called Kitchen Table Nights, where it's from that idea that we used to sit around the kitchen table and tell stories, and that's the way wisdom was passed along. And so Kitchen Table Nights is where we sit around and watch digital stories and talk about them and try and gain wisdom from them. So if you go to commonlanguagedst.com, you can sign up for one of those as well.
So the last question then, and I'd invite the panelists to answer this as well. This, like I've said a few times, this was a very unique project and it was a unique way of collecting data and using data. My question for you and for all of our budding researchers in the audience here is this a method that is only unique to hermeneutics, or can you envision it being used with other methodologies as well? And if so, which ones?
I'm going to defer that because I'm a little biased in my response. So I see such a fit with hermeneutics, it's hard for me to imagine, but you know, maybe someone like Deb, who's done more methodologies than I have, would have a better answer for that.
I don't think it's a better answer. I agree with you, Nancy. I think the hermeneutic approach just bring something very unique to the process, but one could argue that other approaches would bring something else. To me they would lose some of the richness of the meaning in the process of, for example, of doing grounded theory study. You know, is that a possibility? You know, yeah, sure it is. It's definitely a possibility. I could see a grounded theory study around I was really struck by how profoundly healing, you know, an intervention, if you will, from a psychosocial point of view, this is for the participants. And so I could easily see other approaches if your question were quite different. You know, the question here was one of understanding and meaning making. And so I think I think you lose something of the richness of the stories, but you gain something else if your purpose is to theorize, for example. So I mean, I could see other approaches. I wouldn't love them as much either, but.
Yeah, you know, I would say I have lots of ideas about this because I want to, you know, keep researching digital storytelling. I think there's lots of different ways, you know, like Deb said, you know, maybe some sort of RCT where you're running digital storytelling as an intervention and comparing that with something else. You know, another one that I want to do which is more on the watching the story side, is do a natural experiment where you do you watch digital stories and talk about them in weekly staff meetings in one unit and you don't in the other, and see if anything happens. You know, like maybe that would be something that you could do. I think also from a highly very quantitative side, you know, the video allows you to really get a deep experience of the people's inner emotional experiences. So you could do some sort of emotion coding of people's emotional responses and sort of analyze that. And I know my master's supervisor, that's what she does, is she actually videotapes support groups and then quantifies them using emotional expression. And that might be really interesting to look at that and maybe correlate with some sort of psychosocial outcomes, you know. And anyways, I have 100 ideas. I think digital storytelling can be used in lots of ways. I think documentary filmmaking, I have to agree with Nancy and Deb. It's got a real great congruence with hermeneutic research, you know, using documentary to understand, and especially the style, cinema verite, you know, that the style of hermeneutic research and cinema verite documentary filmmaking is meshes so well. It's hard for me to imagine a different one. But digital storytelling, many different ways. I think documentary, I think I would go with hermeneutics too.
Well, we are at the end of our time and it flew by as we knew that it would. Mike, thank you so much for sharing this lovely work that you guys worked so hard on. And I feel like I had a front row seat to all of it. So it was lovely to see it come full circle here. And thank you to our panelists, Dr. Deb McLeod and Dr. Nancy Moules, and to all of you for attending. We really appreciate the turnout. You never know what you're going to get in a forum like this. And so seeing supportive comments and your names, some familiar, some not, is lovely to see. So thank you all for coming out on behalf of the Faculty of Nursing.